want to be able to watch with you what we're talking about. One of the things I want to bring up before I begin is sometimes it's very hard for any of us to recognize the obvious. I come from Minnesota, and where I grew up, and some of you may have also heard on Prairie Home Companion, we have a very large Scandinavian population. And I grew up with all of my friends telling me Sven and Oli stories. And one of the stories that they told me, and that I heard, was the story, in Minnesota, of course, we have a very long winter, and we're cross-training as bowling and ice fishing to stay in shape. So the story is about Sven and Oli and they decide to go ice fishing. And they take their power auger, and they go out on the ice, and fire it up, and they put it right over the ice, and suddenly they hear the voice, "There's no fish under the ice." They look around, they don't know what happened. So they turn off the machine, and take their power auger about 50 feet farther over on the ice, and fire it up, and they hear this voice, "There are no fish under the ice." Sven turns to Oli and says, "Oli, is that God?" And the voice says, "This isn't God, this is the rink manager." That's the story of sometimes what is obvious. I do want to make a very important point before I begin my discussion on what's obvious, is that no one, and I represent many potentially responsible parties through my career, no one wants to be a potentially responsible party in an environmental lawsuit, or being named in an order, or being called a discharger. That is not something that any of us like. At the same time, I believe it's equitable to name all the parties who are potentially responsible parties to an order or to a lawsuit. And that's what this discussion is going to be about. A lot of this information you all already know and have seen before, and we'll move through it very quickly. As you know, and we've all seen the same references, the track thinkers are everywhere. We all know it. We've all used them as we grew up. Our parents used them. They're everywhere. I have clients who have strip malls throughout the state of California. And the very first thing when their the father or the grandfather or the family started the real estate business, the strip malls, was to put in a dry cleaner and a laundromat. And there were two reasons for that. One is, they paid their rent regularly because they had business. And number two, they were going to be a long-term tenant. And they were always there. And the neighborhood needed them. Sometimes you had more than one in a shopping center across the street from each other. I have one site where there are three dry cleaners on three corners, like gas stations. Again, this is all information. Many of you know about the ISA report. It was published in 1992 by the Central Valley Report, Central Valley Regional Water Quality Control Board. And much of the information we'll be talking about today comes from that key report. This is a map from DTSC, and you can see that these are just contaminated wells, drinking water wells, that have been with greater than 5 parts in the MCL, 5 parts per billion, PCE in them. How did PCE get to where it got? Well, a lot of different ways. They were sloppy handling, poor practices, and you can see on this particular picture, this is PCE on the floor going through the cracks in the concrete. PCE was released during deliveries. There is a Florida dry cleaner report, which you can get online, which talks about 15% of the spills and Florida dry cleaners that they found were due to deliveries. The delivery truck would drive up, it had a nozzle and a long hose. The nozzle was like putting gas in your gas tank, and they would bring it in, turn it on, put it in the machine, and then instead of carefully carrying it back to the truck, they would stand at the back of the truck, turn the power wheel on, and the thing would bounce all the way back. And I have a site where I talked with the owner of the dry cleaner, and he said, "Yeah, but every 2 weeks they come, they do that, he figured it spilled a cup of PCE every 2 weeks in the same place in the back parking lot when we found the trail, and had been doing that for 15 years. So that's an example of the kinds of things that can happen. But for us, evaporation of the dry cleaner in the wastewater. We'll be talking about that. Machines produce wastewater from stills, water separators. The still did not look like that. But it's a great picture. I always like that picture. And the interesting thing about wastewater and the use of stills, they put the muck and everything together. There's water used in the dry cleaning process. Not many people know that, because they also there are things in when you get your clothes cleaned, the PC is great on grease. It's terrible on like a sugar stain or a wine stain. They're water soluble. So they put water in and detergent with dry cleaner, often about a cup of water, although in high humidity areas they don't need to do it because the clothes have enough moisture in them from relative humidity. So you end up with water and from the humidity and from the cup that they put in, and they got to separate the water, the dirt, and the PCE to keep using the PCE. And as the important point here of a still is that when you use a still to separate PCE from water, everybody knows about two boiling points. PCE boils at about 121 degrees centigrade, water, of course, at 100. But then the interesting piece is that when you dissolve PCE in water, the azeotrope boils at 88 degrees. So you end up with the dissolved phase, PCE and in water, going with the water as a wastewater discharge. Key questions, and these are pretty, and I'm going to move through this pretty quickly. These are pretty obvious. Who are going to be liable parties for cleaning this stuff up? Shopping centers owners, are they liable? Those are generally kind of people I end up representing in these circumstances. Operators of the dry cleaners, of course, they're liable if it's spilled. Just to mention, Steve mentioned that a lot of spills are documented. I've got those. Manufacturers of dry cleaner. Very interesting question. We'll talk about that in a moment. How about delivery people? The guys who brought the hose in. What about the manufacturers of PCE? And finally, the question we're going to be talking about today is, what about operators of sanitary sewers? Who's liable? Who should pay? Who can't pay? Owner of the real estate, this is obvious. Past owners under SOAR Club, past owners, present owners are liable. They're usually the only deep pocket, but frequently, like in the shopping center situation, they have very few assets. Maybe it's just the shopping center and some rent coming off that shopping center. Been passed down in the family. These are small, generally small businesses. Sure, you might find big ones, but generally not, because strip malls in California were family-owned beginning in the 50s. It was the big way to make money in the real estate business, was to have a series of rents coming from your property. So there'd be developments, and one or two people would own these strip malls. Owners and operators, that's pretty straightforward. The problem is, past owners are hard to find. Very often, the owners of these dry cleaners, the operators, were recent immigrants to the United States. Very often in California, Korean. I've had Vietnamese, I've had Cubans, all first generation, all coming over to the businesses that they get into. As you saw earlier today from the presentation on the Oregon dry cleaners, they buy for about 65% of the of annual sales. So these, they could get in, they could borrow from the bank, they have an operating business, and they could send their kids to school and to college. The problem is that they've all left, they've all gone. Trying to find these people from something that happened in 1978 is very, very, very hard. The equipment manufacturers. I was involved in this case. We sued various equipment manufacturers. I mean, really, what the equipment manufacturers said in their manuals about what to do with wastewater. Multimatic's manual said, the outflowing wastewater from the water separator is contaminated and cannot be used again. Wastewater must flow into an open drain. R.R. Street, Puritan, still said, the water from the separator may be drained into a container or piped directly to a floor drain. The white sniffers were used to collect PCE vapor from the operation of the dry cleaner. The water coming from a separator is wastewater. It should be piped to an open sewer system, as there will be an excess of 10 gallons of water from one operation. Vic, which is a major manufacturer out of Minneapolis, and they sold a lot in California, because only about a gallon or so of water is expected daily, this line could go to a bucket that is periodically emptied. By the way, they were always emptying the toilet, just those of you who are aware of how these things work, or sometimes they were tossed out the back door of the driveway. Then the comment was, let this decision, this could go to a bucket that's periodically empty, let this decision be governed by access to an open floor drain. Well, we sued manufacturers and lost in the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals. You can see why. It, manufacturers were held to be too distant as an arranger. You said it was the operator who did the dirty deed, not the manufacturer. Manuals are just guidance. They didn't have to follow it. Of course, the warranty would have been voided if they didn't follow the manual, but that was ignored by the court. So manufacturers in federal law are not liable. It has not been determined under the in California under HSA, under California statute. It's something that still needs to be brought. PC delivery companies, I mentioned that. The difficulty here is a case on that also. And the judge in the federal court said, I'm not taking an expert's word for this. I need an eyewitness that saw these things happen. I need figs. Well, you've got an expert saying this is where it came from. This is likely the cause of this. The judge said, without an eyewitness, I'm not going to take that case. Manufacturers of PC, the city of Modesto litigation is still ongoing. The city of Modesto is suing. And I think it's probably another 5 years before we know eventually what happens, and that's got to go to the Court of Appeals. But that has been successful under common law innocence. This is a dry clean. This is an old picture of a dry cleaner, the way it used to be. And it has each one is separate, as you see my dot. This is now sort of all combined. In fact, many things are combined. The dry cleaner and washer are now one unit. In the old days, you would move the clothes in the PC and it would drip all over the floor, like that picture I showed you. But the most important thing about this document, about this picture, is every blue square that you see. Every blue square is where wastewater is coming out of that facility. Every blue square has the potential to have 150,000 parts per billion of PCE dissolved in the wastewater. In addition, the ones down here from the water separator, that one, that could have pure solvent. Because when they separated the PCE and the water, PCE being 1.6 times as heavy as water, would sit on the bottom and the top would be water. They drain off the water, that went to the sanitary sewer. The difficulty was that they weren't always accurate. So they'd often get a little bit of PCE, or they could be mixed, there'd be bubbles of PCE in the water, so you'd be discharging DNAP, or pure PCE, into the sanitary sewer. I don't know how well you can see this. This is an Oregon picture. This was a dry cleaner that got cleaned up. It was not yet, but it was in the process. They removed the equipment. This is all the piping down there that's going into a floor drain. It's an example of what it looks like. And they're very, it varies over time. Sometimes they'll find the floor drain was removed because they put in new equipment. It'll be two, three, four, five generations of equipment in a particular dry cleaner. All right, let's talk about sanitary sewers. And again, no one wants to be in a PRP. And my view on this is it's equitable in all ways. And my view is on this, and I'm sure there are others who disagree, but it's my view that a sanitary sewer is one key piece of the puzzle in identifying how PCE is entering the environment and how it's getting into the various neighborhoods. These are the various case law on the subject. There's West Farm, which is first, they said that for public policy purposes, we're going to consider, in fact, they rejected the argument that for public policy purposes, the sewer should be excluded. It was a dry cleaner case involving the International Sanitary Institute. Lincoln Properties is a key case back in 1992, and it talks about, and just to remind everybody about CERCLA and what liability is, and I'll go very quickly, there has to be a release or a threatened release. The release has to cause associated with it. And the has to be a facility, and the West Farm case determined the sewers are a facility. And then there has to be a responsible party that fits in one of the four categories: owner, operator, property manager, property owner, transporter, or arranger of the categories. These cases in California, first Lincoln and then Adobe, talk about that there's liability, but there are affirmative defenses to the liability. An affirmative defense in the law means that the person who's being sued, the defendant, has to prove that they're innocent. Now, it's not the same as a criminal case because you only have to carry a burden of proof of 51%. But you have the burden of proof as a defendant to say that you're not the one that did these things. And the standards are that you have to, that the other guy, the person who poured the DC down the store, was the sole cause. You have to prove that you exercised due care. And you have to prove that you took precautions against foreseeable acts of others. Those are the standards of proof. And what's important about Adobe, it said that even if released to the sewer by a dry cleaner, even if it violated the law, in that case, the release was still foreseeable because people violate the law all the time. And then they also found in that case that repairs of sewers after failure, the street collapsed, or people were complaining, documentation of joints and settings, they were not responded to until there was a failure. There are evidence of inadequate due care. You have to have proactive maintenance, that court said, for there to be to prove that you had exercised due care. You move on quickly. What am I doing? All right, I'll move even more quickly. Under the water code, there's strict liability. This is a sewer. Sanitary districts are discharges. And there are precedents for naming sanitary sewers as discharges. The Central Valley did so in the City of Lodi case in 2004. And talk about that case when we're in question and answer period. Sewers leak by design and through their maintenance. In the old days, and this is pictures from the pictures of, see the crack along that sewer? There's a reason that sanitary sewers are the bottom utility. When we install utilities anywhere in the country, they're always the bottom one because you don't want to take a chance of the sewer leaking into your drinking water. You always put it at the bottom. There were old design requirements, inadequate and poor maintenance. These are the kinds of things that can happen. Gaskets fail. In the old days, they used Opalin jute. I had to ask my dad years ago what Opalin jute were, but it's a fibrous material. You guys probably know about it. And there were gaskets failed, and sometimes sewers were installed with a flat grating or into the groundwater. Their sags are very, very, very common. The pipe composition allowed PCE to get out. So we can, and as the ISO report said, even intact sewers, in fact, very likely, intact sewers leak PCE because of the nature of the structure of the sewer pipe itself, concrete, so on. All right, these are the kinds of things he's talking about. Asserting meeting industry standards doesn't, is not a defense to liability under environmental laws. This is from the ISO report. I recommend you get it off the internet. It's a great report, but it goes into how sewers leak and why, and how PCE can escape from sewers. The bottom line is, wastewater is discharged to sanitary sewers. Sewers were poorly designed. Sanitary districts are responsible responsible parties to discharges. And that affirmative defenses to this liability are very difficult for sanitary districts to prove. The question is, should we still hold them liable or not? And my view is that they are. It's a serious problem. We have no money. And the most important thing I want to point out here is that there it is. Something that everybody's talking about today, insurance. Districts have CGL policies. They've got better records than anybody. They may not be seen. They've kept their records, they have huge policy amounts, and they're available if they're triggered. Very quickly, the Ameron case exists. Greg, I think you were the one that asked about if there's litigation, if there's an order. The Foster Gardner case in the mid-90s, the Supreme Court of California said, a suit has to be actually litigation. An order doesn't do it. That involves a TTSC order. So we've all, as lawyers, been saying, geez, we've got to come up with a suit. So we often sue the operator and hope the operator sues the property owner back, triggering the insurance, all these different things that we have to come up with. But the Ameron case, which was two years ago, said that a contested administrative complaint, they found that to be covered by insurance. So it may be, hasn't been tested yet, no one's done this, and a number of us have been talking about it, but we wait for litigation, we wait for Ray, you to sue us, we have to get the DA, and that might trigger all of this. We'll have to wait and see. And it may be following through. It doesn't sound like an order will do it, but it may be other things. All right. These are the arguments and the rebuttals what the districts are likely to argue, why they shouldn't be named parties. I think these are all going to be available. Is that right? All of my slides? So if you can take a look, these are the various reasons they think they should not be liable. These are my rebuttals to their comments. People are named all the time. These are more of those. So the bottom line is, I'm not asking that anybody in any sanitary district be liable for that mess or for this basement underneath a dry cleaner, but I'm arguing about these things. You can see that's a leaking sewer pipe, and that's what a root is, really, a great root intrusion. That'd make a great neighborhood. I don't know. So that's all I got, and I welcome any questions you may have.
To address the very narrow issue of whether or not to ask the regional board to add a sewer district as a responsible party or discharge it. And just, you mentioned the City of Lodi case, and there is actually another one. And the point you just made about those being very narrow circumstances is in fact true. And so the suggestion I have for the advice for all of you consultants in the room is if you are dealing with a situation where you have very limited resources, a litigation case, but just a regional board order asking your client to do something. And again, you have these very limited resources. Again, it's only happened twice that regional boards have added sewer districts as dischargers. You may want to focus those limited resources on the task the regional board wants to get to closure for site characterization and litigation. So, really good advice.
And my response is that they still should be named. My view, and I know it's happened twice. I got to sit and talk about City of Lodi, and to thank you for the comment. Yeah, it's a crucial question, and the problem is that there are limited resources by property owners. There are limited resources. They're just limited resources, and the advantage of sanitary districts is that they do have insurance. That's a crucial issue for all of us. Yeah.
Well, at the risk of getting fired. You know, a lot of the discussion today has been about finding someone to pay for an industry that causes damage larger than its value. You know, one of the sort of untouched but big elephants in the room is why not a penny per 100 cubic foot fee on drinking water? So it's ultimately the goal of a lot of these things is drinking water protection. So the water utilities have large sums of money in the revenue they collect. They pay a small percentage of that, which is basically an orphan site fund that enables dry cleaners and other sites for which viable RPs and insurance policies cannot be found. That might be another angle at that. I wonder if you have any thoughts on water utilities or other sources of revenue that might come into play to solve the problem.
It's probably beyond my scope, but I will make one interesting comment. At the end of the ISO report, 1992, I think he said that. His last statement of that, just I'll read to you. Groundwater cleanup is required so that water supply agencies can continue to provide safe water. Deciding who should investigate and clean up groundwater is a complex political legal issue. Since the PCE discharges from dry cleaners were all approved, standard practice, and those from the sewers were unsuspected. Because most dry cleaners are small businesses, which may not have the financial capabilities to define the contamination plume and conduct cleanup, other resources may be needed. A statewide cleanup fund may be appropriate. If no one else cleans up the groundwater, water supply agencies will have to do it by default. That was his conclusion in 1992. And I'm arguing an alternative approach, given that there are specific facts. Obviously, all legal cases involve specific facts. Some facts are more egregious than others. There are sanitary districts that do great jobs, there are sanitary districts that do poor jobs. And the facts are crucial to any analysis.